issue. I'd like to ask you some questions about the ban on Dorje Shugden. I have heard many different reasons for the Dalai Lama's ban on the practice of Dorje Shugden. Would you please give me all of the reasons for this ban that you are aware of?
I think if you basically sum up the reasons for which the Dalai Lama has put the ban, you can straight away give two reasons for that. One is basically his hidden political agenda, if I might say. And the second is because he feels a unity is going to be achieved by bringing about a ban on Dorje Shugden. Of course, that is not really correct or true, neither of these. That is because Dorje Shugden is in no way an obstacle to unity of all the sects. There's a lot of lies being said about these kind of things, that Dorje Shugden is a major obstacle to the unity of all sects. In fact, all the different traditions, I would rather prefer to call it tradition than sects, all the different traditions of Tibet have their own unique protectors. And each of those unique protectors are uncommon protectors of those respective traditions and lineages. So why is Dorje Shugden being singled out as the big enemy of unity and being singled out as the main object of sectarianism? That is absolutely not true. It's a big lie. Actually, the main reason behind the ban on Dorje Shugden is because Dorje Shugden has been very, very popular. You see, Gelugpas have been a majority in Tibet. They happen to be a majority also in exile. Now, I'm not saying that's good, that they are a majority. I'm not capitalizing on the majority stuff. What I'm basically saying is that in numbers, it so happens that Gelugpas are a majority. Again, it so happens that Dorje Shugden worship is also, very, very popular amongst the Gelugpas. But let us say it's not only popular amongst the Gelugpas, it's also very popular amongst the Sakyapas, which is the other tradition. So, I think this popularity may have caused some constraint and jealousy amongst certain practitioners of the Kagyu and Nyingmapa, specifically certain practitioners of the Nyingmapas. Now, jealousy and competition in connection to growing popularity of your neighbor or somebody else is a common aspect, and in the history of Tibet there has always been this tussle and quarrel and disagreement and argument on the basis of fame, popularity, patrons, property, disciples. So these are typical, peculiar, you know, human failings, human problems. They have nothing to do with sectarianism within the protector of the Gelugpas such as Dorje Shugden, or even within protectors of Nyingmapas such as the protector Rahula or Ekasati or the unique protectors of the Nyingmapa. There are only certain invested people who come up with these issues to make trouble. That is because they are not true Nyingmapas. They are not true Gelugpas. They are not true Sakyapas. A real practitioner of one's own lineage would not create these problems. The real problem and obstacle to anything what you might call a progress is basically the three poisons and ignorance and affliction. So why is the Dalai Lama basically taking people for a ride by putting the blame or the cap of blame on Dorje Shugden specifically? This is my reason for saying that this ban is basically non-valid, unreasonable.
The Dalai Lama has given two reasons for his imposition of the ban. First, that the ban is injurious to his health and to his life. Also, that it is contrary to the national interests of Tibet. Can you give your reaction to those reasons?
You see, as I was saying, basically, you see, a true Buddhist practitioner ought to identify no other harm, you see, within the physical or mental sphere, within cyclic existence, samsara, or throughout phenomena. The biggest harm is the harm of one's own ignorance, the harm of the three poisons, desire, hatred, and delusion. The ultimate harm, if we might put it, is, you see, gross afflictions and the subtle afflictions, and if these two are removed, you have no harm, you have no problem, you are enlightened, you are free of all problems, you have no harms. So it is a tragedy that a person such as in the standing of that of the Dalai Lama ought to use such a petty reason to justify a ban singularly on one particular deity and on the protector of one particular tradition, that is of the Gelugpas, the ban on Dorje Shugden. I think this is absolutely not true, that Dorje Shugden is harmful towards the cause of Tibet. If there has been anything in the past that has been harmful, and in the present that has been harmful towards the general cause of a nation or of its people, you should identify that as the bad karma or the collective karma as a true Buddhist, and not really, you know, put the blame on somebody else's protectors or somebody else's belief. Besides, this thing about Dorje Shugden causing harm to the Dalai Lama's health is incredible. In one sense, you are supposed to believe that the Dalai Lama himself is a manifestation of the enlightened Buddha. In general, he is supposed to be the emanation of the Buddha of compassion. And here in the same breath, he says that an evil spirit, which he basically refers to as a Chinese spirit, is harming him. You see, that's really a bit hilarious. I mean, that's really funny, specifically because, you see, as a Buddhist, you take refuge in the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, that which is called the Triple Gem. And the benefits of sincerely taking refuge is, one of the eight benefits is, you do not experience any harms of evil spirits and demons, whatever you might call that, I mean, whether you believe in evil spirits or demons. But in general, if there is any harm, physical or non-physical, it cannot harm a person generally who has taken refuge in the Triple Gem. For the Dalai Lama to say that Dorje Shugden is harming him, basically, from a Buddhist point of view, it would mean that the Dalai Lama does not seem to have refuge. If he does not seem to have refuge, then I conclude, how is it possible that he is a Buddhist teacher?
You referred in one of your reasons to the Dalai Lama's political agenda in imposing the ban. Could you elaborate on that, please?
Mm-hmm. You see, what I mean to say by the Dalai Lama's political agenda is that actually Dorje Shugden has been made a scapegoat for his political and his spiritual failures. This is rather scandalizing, really shameful. Actually, you see, since when the Stratospoke, what do you call that, Stratospoke proposal was made, he basically renounced the idea of a free Tibet. Now, since 1959, he has encouraged or propagated very strongly the idea of a free Tibet, a fully independent Tibet. But it was in 1989, and much before, perhaps even much before the Strasbourg proposal, that he must have realized that it was absolutely irrational or impossible for him to be demanding full independence or complete independence of Tibet, given the circumstances that Tibet is at present. So it was basically during the Strasbourg proposal that he had renounced the idea of a free Tibet, of a completely independent Tibet. But as I said, because he had been propagating complete Tibet and full independence for Tibet since 1959, so it had been difficult for him to convince people that this was not going to be possible. You see the masses of Tibet. So eventually, before he decided that he could actually tell the people that he opted for full autonomy instead of complete independence, he very skillfully put the blame on Dorje Shugden by saying that Dorje Shugden is the major problem to my being able to achieve full independence, complete freedom for Tibet. So, you see, that goes to say that he used a religious issue and made it into a political one. This is what I mean by saying that he had a hidden political agenda. The other thing about Dorje Shugden being an obstacle to the unity of all the Tibetan traditions and Tibetan lineages is definitely not true. You see, prior to the Dalai Lama blowing the issue of Dorje Shugden and making it into a controversy out of proportions, there was no such problem in the beginning. If there was such a problem in the beginning, why didn't he think about it 20 years before? There was neither such problems of proportions as he has been depicted it in Tibet also. So now it has been blown out of proportions, and he says Dorje Shugden is a problem towards bringing about unity of all the different lineages and traditions. That's not true. That's absolutely not true. Why? Because when he talks about bringing unity, he's talking about making one tradition out of all the existing traditions of Tibet. Now, if you're going to ask the Nyingmapas and the Sakyapas and the Kagyupas and, of course, the Gelugpas, including that, are you going to give up your unique individuality and your unique unbroken lineage passing down from Shakyamuni to your master, and your unique traditions in an unbroken form, that heritage, are you going to give it up to make a united sect consisting of practices of all different traditions? Not a single Nyingmapa or Sakyapa or even Kajupa is going to agree to that. Well, there may be exceptions of individual cases, but I guarantee you, there won't be anybody to go in for this particular idea. So because to everybody, their particular lineage and their particular tradition is very important. Because when you lose that uniqueness of your own individual tradition, unbroken lineage, you lose a blessing. And what the Dalai Lama is talking about, therefore, is basically uniting of all practices and making one tradition. And if you ask, who is then intended to be the head of this new one tradition? Of course, it's the Dalai Lama himself who's going to be the head. So therefore, you see, I'm trying to explain this because it is very clear to the Dalai Lama's mind that when he goes back to Tibet, if he ever in his lifetime goes back to Tibet, he's never ever going to be the temporal leader. That's very clear. Since he's opted for autonomy, he's not going to be a temporal leader anymore. So the only option left for him is to be a spiritual leader. If he ought to be a spiritual leader, to be a spiritual leader of the Gelugpas alone means his strength is marginalized, is reduced. Therefore, in order to be a common spiritual leader of all the different traditions, if he creates one such tradition here in exile, I suppose he believes that when he goes back to Tibet, he will be able to control and to be able to sort of exercise power over all the traditions by virtue of having created this one tradition of which he is the supreme leader. So this is also a power struggle. This is also a power game. And it's again the same, a hidden political agenda. That's what I'm trying to say.
How does the Dalai Lama's attempt at creating the synthesis of the four schools, how does the ban, the Dalai Lama's ban on the practice of Dorje Shugden function to enable him, at least from his own point of view, to accomplish this synthesis?
How does
the practice of Dorje Shugden function to obstruct the fulfillment of his plan to create a unified, single tradition of Tibetan Buddhism?
Well, you see, it is the Dalai Lama's understanding and the Dalai Lama's wrong notion, if I might put it that way, along with a collective group of individuals who have misconceived, or let us say, developed the idea that the practitioners of Dorje Shugden are sectarian. They are fundamentalists in nature. They are extremists. That their agenda basically is a hidden political agenda, you see? And that they are basically anti-eclectic and anti-ecumenical. They are against other traditions. Now this is veritably a false accusation, which is absolutely not true. So, because of this false notion, the Dalai Lama feels that if he removes the practice of Dorje Shugden, then he removes sectarianism and fundamentalism, and by removing sectarianism and fundamentalism and factionalism, which is very deeply ingrained in Tibetan society, he's hoping to gain that unity and that he's that what you call that possibility of being able to create one tradition, which he's talking about.
Thank you. What I'd like to do now is to turn my questions from talking about the causes for the ban, the objectives, the Dalai Lama's objectives for imposing this ban, to the effects that this ban is having, to the effects that this ban is having. First of all, I'd like to ask you, what effect has this ban had on you personally? What has been your personal experience as a result of the imposition of this ban?
Well, as you know, the general effect of this ban has really been terrible and not good for many people. But since you are asking to me more an individual question, let me tell you something like this. I am just an ordinary Tibetan Buddhist monk and supposedly a Tibetan Gelugpa Lama. And I run a small monastic institute in the south of India, in the Bangalore city in the Karnataka state of India. And I have a small charitable trust too. We don't have many benefactors or supporters who help us carry on our small community and who help us financially. So in that sense, you know, I don't necessarily experience this loss of benefactors, friends and supporters like the bigger organizations or bigger institutes or bigger groups of practicing Dorje Shugden followers have been experiencing. What I have, although of course been experiencing, is a lot of slander and character assassination since the last 2 years. And because of the bad name and propaganda being spread about me individually, singularly, and that of my organization itself in the local Tibetan newspapers, in which they have carried all sorts of false allegations about me and about our institute. So this has sort of made many, many people and many friends who may have earlier been interested about us and our work sort of repulsive of us. And so we have lost quite a number of friends. Now, as far as my personal safety is concerned and my own life is concerned, it has completely been jeopardized. I had a house in the north of Karnataka in the monastery called Depungomang, which is within the Tibetan settlement, refugee settlement. And I can no more go back there, because if I go there, I've been told that I will be beaten, I will be killed. There were posters and there were letters hung up on the walls to that extent, saying that if I ever came back there, I would be killed. And besides, I was personally attacked during the 16th of May in 1996. There were about 70 or 72 strong group of Tibetans who had come on my residence in Bangalore, and they were shouting for me, yelling for me, hurling abuses and threatening us. And I wasn't there exactly. I was out of station. I was in the Bailakupi settlement, Mysore. I was there preparing for the peace protest with the monks in the Serame monastery. And so I believe if I would have been there, I would have been manhandled. And since then, I've never been safe. I've had to go in hiding on two occasions. That was in the year 1996 itself, and 1997 once again, when the security department of the Dalai Lama or the private office of the Dalai Lama, private secretariat, what they call it, had said to the media, in connection to the unfortunate incident of murder of the Buddhist teacher Lobsang Gyatso, these two offices of the Dalai Lama had basically said that they were going to carry an investigation, and they were going to investigate Bangalore, Milan in Italy, Switzerland, and the two monastic settlements in Mandkot and Bailakupi. And so, although a statement like this given out by the private secretariat office of the Dalai Lama or, you know, the Department of Security of the Dalai Lama may not sound as a threat, but it's evident, it's very evident what these offices of the Dalai Lama, what these departmental offices of the Dalai Lama can do. Like, for example, they could bribe local Indian authorities and police to sort of, you know, based on false accusation, to have us arrested, harassed, and all these kind of things. So there was this possibility of threat. And in fact, actually, the Dalai Lama's governmental departments are in fact inciting, or let us say manipulating, the police even today, hampering the movement of two of our most prominent members of the Dorje Shugden Devotees Charitable and Religious Trust Society in Delhi. But that's a fact. And they can do that to them because they are Tibetan refugees. So Tibetan refugees basically come under the denomination of the sort of surveillance of the Tibetan government in exile. They cannot do that to me because I'm an Indian citizen. But I didn't take any chances, because my being an Indian citizen alone does not mean that I won't be persecuted or I won't be harassed. Because there is this corruption in the high level and even in the small departments and police departments in India. So they have the money to do that, so they could harass me. So instead of taking any chances, I left again and traveled extensively to the Southeast Asian countries and remained for 1 year outside Bangalore.
How did the ban affect you personally, deep in your heart? How did you react to the ban? What were your deep thoughts and feelings about this ban?
Well, I felt a sense of something deep down in my heart, as if it was something was sinking deep down. I felt terrible. I felt very, very sad. I can't tell you how sad I felt and how surprised and how astonished I was to experience the fact that, you see, behind this ban and behind all these outrageous lies and statements, sort of contradictory statements, made by no other person than the Dalai Lama himself. I was very shocked and sad, if I might put it that way, you see. I was shocked and sad. Why? Because I worked very hard for the Dalai Lama. In fact, for these last 5 or 6 years since I was out of my monastery and traveling, everywhere that I went, everything that I did was always towards the fulfillment of his wishes, his aspirations. Like every Tibetan, like every Western Buddhist practitioner who, generally speaking, is captivated by the personality and the person of the Dalai Lama, in the sense that they believe that he symbolizes tolerance and compassion, loving kindness, justice. It was quite shocking to discover that this was not true. Actually, I had heard quite a lot of stories and rumors about what was really happening around the Dalai Lama and the other side of the Dalai Lama, but I didn't really believe it until this ban and all the lies and propaganda that was spread. That was really shocking to me. That was very painful to me. So, in my mind, I was almost sort of blackened out for at least a month or two. I couldn't make any decision. I just didn't know what to do. I just didn't know where to go, who to talk to. And would it not have been for Dorje Shugden himself and my own recollection of what Kyabji Song Rumichi had basically said in the past as a future prophecy of things that would happen, I regained a certain sense of confidence once again, feeling that, well, you just can't sit tight with your hands, you know, folded on a sofa or on a chair and say, oh dear, you know, something has to be done about it. And so, since then, you see, I've been up on my feet and traveling all over the world, something I've never ever done, gone to the most remotest parts of different countries. I found myself become some kind of a traveler. And that's what has happened, basically. But I keep on traveling to as many places as I can, meeting as many people as I can, and trying to speak to as many organizations or individuals, persons, monks, nuns, whoever, politician, NGOs, whatever. Wherever I can, you know, even beg, fold my hands and fall down on my knees and I can beg and beseech people, I do that. And I'm doing that solely, you know, at my own initiative and at my own care, at my own will. Sometimes I have to do that on my own financial backing, which is absolutely really precarious, because I don't have such financial backing to sustain everything that I do, like having to travel or having to send letters off and do things. And sometimes I'm helped by individuals and friends, happily speaking, which gives me some kind of comfort that there are other people also who are trying to contribute towards it. So whatever it is, I keep on traveling and I keep on justifying and removing the false propaganda and trying to tell the people truth. I believe only time will tell. Time will tell eventually who is really telling the truth, whether the Dalai Lama is telling the truth or whether we, the followers of Dorje Shugden, are telling the truth.
in these activities that you're engaged in now, such as even being present here in New York to grant interviews such as this one, has your life been in any way put into danger?
Well, I can't really say, I can't really say my life has not been put in danger or has been put in danger. I'm not really sure what will happen after this. I'm going to be here around for some time. But sometime in the year later, I have to be back to India. I have to be back to see my institute. That's my base, that's my home. The Dorje Shugden problem may be solved within a matter of a year or within a matter of 3 years or even 4 or 5 or 6 or 10, who knows. But then I have to carry on my life, you see. I have to carry on with my work. And so, okay, if I'm supposed to drop dead with working for Dorje Shugden, I think so be it. But I think it's a pity also if I don't pick it up from somewhere, or if I'm absolutely left in no position to be able to pick up from where I begun. I would think it's a great pity, because what I'm trying to do in India with my monastic institute is trying to give young Tibetans the possibility of being able to train in a much more democratic atmosphere, where they can develop much more skills and be productive Buddhists who will really help in the mainstream of society, and not just, you know, meditating Buddhists who sit there beating drums and cymbals and chanting and meditating all the day. I really believe in some action amongst Buddhists, and currently I think amongst the younger generation, or even the older generation of lamas. I think I'm possibly the only person doing that. So maybe I'm being labeled as radical or stupid or overdoing things or whatever. But I believe I have a good intention. I have the support of my teachers, and I'm trying to do my best. I'm trying to basically make Dharma and the Ganden tradition of Lama Tsongkhapa look like a valid practical tradition, not a tradition and a system based off a group of daydreaming meditators and impractical people who have no other job and just have looked for an escape. So I'm looking for an alternative and for a means to make a very profound and very sublime tradition look more powerful and active. Whereas, like the very traditional lamas and geshis who are within their centers and disciples, I'm also doing the same thing of trying to keep up the traditional practices by preserving what I can myself, and by helping and trying to maintain that practice and that preservation within our small monastic community. So, therefore, I need to pick up on that after I survive from this ordeal, hopefully.
How have your students been affected, either directly? Could you share with us your assessment of how your students and how your work has been affected, in quite concrete terms, if it has, by the ban, the Dalai Lama's ban? You may need initially to once again describe briefly what the nature of your work is, and then how has that, including your students, been affected by the imposition of this ban?
Well, you see, 6 years back, I used to live in the Depung Gomang Monastery, and I was basically at the mercy of the monastery. You see, my food came from that monastery. And the house which I was living, of course, belonged to me. But the rest, everything, I was dependent on the monastery. When I started moving out from the monastery in early 1987 onwards, when I started moving out of the monastery and traveling, then I developed some friends who were initially also were my students. And so with their help and their patronship, my economical circumstances, of course, became somewhat better, because of which I could travel. You see, I used those economical possibilities to be able to travel outside and to be able to meet more people and to be able to sort of do the things, concentrate on the things, on the projects which, generally speaking, I cherished very much from the very beginning. So eventually I traveled to the United States in 1990 and 1991 respectively, and there I developed some friendship with people also, and initially I found some financial help there too. So because of which I could also use that money to help the monastic institution of Gomang and other projects amongst the Tibetan women's organization and other places in India. Now eventually I started traveling to Europe since 1991, which I've been doing until 1995. And it's now since the last 2 years that I've not been in Europe. This year I'm going to Europe, of course. So in Europe I met with a couple who became my students, very good students, and my benefactors. With their help, I could move out from the monastery. You see, at that time, it was very initially important for me to move out from the monastery. But in order to be able to move out from the monastery, it would be necessary for me to have enough money to be able to rent a house somewhere and to live and to be able to pay, you know, the bills for the food and electricity and all that kind of things. So with the help of these two benefactors, I mean this couple, I could really be able to sustain myself outside the monastery, which gave me more freedom. I feel especially very grateful to this couple. Why? Because they are very good, very kind people, and they are economically well-to-do. And they were very kind, even from the very beginning, to think about, you know, helping me to be able to settle down outside the monastery. I think if this couple wouldn't have helped me initially, I would be inside the monastery. And I think if I would be inside the monastery, I would be in no capable condition to be what I'm being able to do, the things as I'm doing today. You see? So, you see, initially, I think with the help of Dorje Shugden, perhaps through his blessings, that I met this couple and I could come out of the monastery and develop my own independent lifestyle. And then, as I had always cherished to have a monastic institute different from that of all the traditional setups. So I eventually, since 1993, slowly built up, and today we have a community of 7 monks. Now that's absolutely nothing compared to even organizations in the West where they have even much more larger number of monks. But I'm very happy because our programs go very well, and with the help of this couple we can still pay the rent of the house and we can still be able to feed all our members. And basically whenever I go out to Europe, wherever I teach, wherever I lecture, in some of the places where I lecture, where I'm paid from that money and from what people offer me, I use that to basically feed the monastic community. We haven't really developed, you know, that great publicity for our community and the things that we do. So we do not really, as I've already stated, have such large financial resources to be able to care, to take care of this monastic institute. But you see, since the beginning of the controversy, that is, since the last 2 years, I used to also travel to Germany, to quite a number of places, and I used to have friends at other places and possibilities of being able to really sort of generate funds for our community. But I lost all those contacts because these people were quite disgusted with the fact that I was the spokesman for Dorje Shugden. So I lost some friends and I lost some benefactors and sponsors, and that made it very difficult for me, of course. So that also made it difficult for me to be able to increase our numbers or to be able to move out in a different place. We had other different projects also which needed attention, which needed time and development, which meant that I needed more time to stay in Bangalore and be able to move around and speak with different kinds of people. And that just couldn't happen. So basically what happened was that our charitable trust and the maintenance of our charitable trust, especially our working staff, in our absence, the quality of the work was absolutely going down. And we were not able to pay the salary of our working staff, as a result of which we had to reduce the number of our working staff. And that meant those benefactors or sponsors in the West who were not getting reports on time, who were not getting the right financial sort of reports and so on, reports on the projects, were becoming very irritated. So right now, they're quite irritated. And I don't know how to tell them, whether to tell them that, look, my life was jeopardized and I was in exile and so I couldn't do anything about it. Whether that's a good reason or not, I can't say. That was one very big problem that I had to face. And the other problems were, of course, I lost many, many students and friends in Italy, in Germany. Within Holland also, I lost a few friends and a few people. Within India, I became isolated from the community that I used to help and work for, the major Tibetan communities. So it was like becoming marooned, you know, in an island. But anyway, that hasn't really made us drop dead, you know. We still live, we still can pay our bills, we still can manage, so it's not really that big a problem. But since you asked me specifically what problems it had created, so I'm giving you specifically the answers.
Thank you. Do you have any family or relatives that have been affected by this ban? Or has it affected your relationship with any of your family or relatives?
Well, frankly speaking, that has not been the case with my family and my relatives. Of course, my brother was a little concerned, you know, about, I have a younger brother, and he was a bit concerned about my stand and about my going to the press and openly speaking out against the ban and all this kind of things. So he was suggesting that I better take it cool, you know. But eventually he's almost come to learn a lot about the other side of the story. So it's no bigger problem.
From your direct observation, first of all, and then from what you've heard, can you share with us how this ban has affected Tibetans. First of all, has it created any problems for monks and monasteries? Also, what kind of problems have you been aware of that it's created for lay people in the Tibetan settlements?
Well, as I can say, the destructive influence or the destruction.
Can you share with us how this ban has affected Tibetans? First of all, has it created any problems for monks and monasteries? Also, what kind of problems have you been aware of that it's created for lay people in the Tibetan settlements?
Well, as I can say, the destructive influence or the destructive effects of this ban has been extensively, exceptionally, if I might put it, all-pervasive and sort of completely encompassing the whole of Tibetan society as a whole, in the sense that not only has it affected the lay community, but it has also affected the monasteries. There was never a schism in the monastery. There is now schism in all the major Buddhist Tibetan Gelugpa monastic centers. There was never such a dividing factor amongst Tibetan people. You know, there have been many other issues like this, which has racked up the Tibetan community and the society occasionally. And these issues have almost all of them been dumb issues, not really that serious an issue. And it often looked threatening and becoming ruinous for the Tibetan society. But that has really never happened. But with this ban, a real sort of division has taken place between many Tibetans. So the son has become suspecting of the mother has become suspecting of the daughter. Couples have separated on the basis of this ban. Friends have become enemies. People look at each other with suspicion. People, when they meet each other, don't even talk to each other because they suspect one or the other might be a Shugden practitioner. And it would be very bad to be talking to a Shugden practitioner. You can imagine then how a Shugden practitioner would become in this case, you see, absolutely marooned and isolated. So basically, in short, you feel like absolutely like excrement, like you are excrement, you are nothing, you are not a human being. You're just mere shit, excuse my language, but that's what that's what it's made us all look like. It's incredible.
You say that the ban has affected the monasteries, has caused division in the monastery. What kind of populations of monks in the monasteries are we talking about?
Well, if you take the Sera Monastery, for instance, Sera Monastery has a population of almost 4,000 monks. Within the Sera Me and the Sera Je Monastery has a majority. There are practitioners of Dorje Shugden, but now they become like the pariahs within the Sera Je Monastery. There are very important, prominent people who are Dorje Shugden followers there, but they're almost sort of in hiding. They can't talk about their involvement with Dorje Shugden. It's like as if you are a lecherous person if you are a follower of Dorje Shugden. You are a leprous person if you are a follower of Dorje Shugden. You shouldn't exist because you are a follower of Dorje Shugden. You are just, you know, a nuisance to society, a louse. The same goes in the Serame College, you see. There are at least more than 600 monks who are followers of Dorje Shugden, and the rest who are not followers of Dorje Shugden. Now there has been a schism now, because those who don't follow Dorje Shugden consider themselves to be absolutely pure, immaculate. They consider Dorje Shugden followers to be dirty, filthy, evil, satanic. In Depung, there is a minority of Dorje Shugden followers. They are almost sort of, you know, have been expelled out of the monastery. I am from Depung Gomang. I don't know whether I've been verbally, whether the Depung Gomang monastery has verbally, orally, literally said that they have expelled me out of the monastery, but I guarantee you, within the coming months or weeks, if they hear and they see what I'm doing, it's guaranteed that they will orally, literally expel me out of the monastery. Now, within Ganden, you have Shatse College and Jangse College. In Shatse College, you have the majority of Dorje Shugden practitioner. Jangse College also has Dorje Shugden practitioners, but they are still a minority. Those who are speaking out against the Dorje Shugden practitioners are almost all the younger generation of monks. It goes to go the same for Serje. It goes to say the same for Serame. These are all the younger generation of monks, and a few misconceived senior monks who are speaking out against Dorje Shugden. If you make an investigation, you will see that those involved with Dorje Shugden are the real dedicated people with a lot of knowledge and integrity. And those not involved with Dorje Shugden people are really notorious kind of people with all kinds of, you know, political agendas and not really concerned about the doctrine, the teachings of Lama Tsongkhapa.
Now, when you say a prominent senior people, are you talking now about lamas, reincarnate tulkus, geshes, who are practitioners of Dorje Shugden?
Yes. Of course, the persons that I'm speaking of consists of lamas, geshes, and so on, and of course also well-known monks and so on. But I'm speaking specifically of very dedicated people who have, throughout half their lives, contributed towards the welfare of their monastic institutes, contributed towards the welfare of the Tibetan communities, given all they've had for the people, have lived an exemplary life of purity and spiritual practice. And it seems now this is all for nothing, that they are all being called demonic, satanic people who are sort of, you know, worse than the communist Chinese or worse than any sort of what you call criminal people, as if they have caused a great harm to everybody. This is a tragedy. This is a catastrophe.
Have these kinds of statements or are these kinds of accusations caused any instances of violence within the monastic communities that you may have either witnessed yourself or heard about?
You see, of course it has caused violence. Of course it has caused a lot of bad feeling and rift between the monks. There have been cases of Dorje Shugden, practitioner, was beaten up by pro Dalai Lama monks within the Jiangsu College. Not only that, 11 monks have been expelled just because they took part in a peaceful demonstration. Merely because they took part in a peaceful demonstration. Now the rules of the monastery does not say that if you take part in a peaceful demonstration, you will be expelled. No monastic rule says that if you take a part in a demonstration opposing the ban of the Dalai Lama, you are expelled. The Dalai Lama may be a political and temporal head, so to say, for the Tibetans. But the head of the monasteries are the respective abbots. And the head of the Gelugpa sect, generally speaking, is the Ganden throne holder, the Gelugpa Pope. This Ganden throne holder has been basically, you see, elected by the Dalai Lama. So he's more a Dalai Lama man than a man for Gelugpas. So when I say the Ganden throne holder is the head of the Gelugpa, I say that with caution. So you see, what has happened is, in my case, and in the case of my guru, my teacher, for example, we have become the pariahs in the monastery. We are outcasts. We are no human beings for them. Whatever we have done in the past, in the case of my own guru, he has given plenty of teachings in that very monastery to hundreds and hundreds of monks over there. And all of these monks have turned now against him to listen to the Dalai Lama. What has the Dalai Lama done for them that my teacher and my guru has done for them? You see, so a lot of people in robes have also turned out to become ungrateful, have basically abandoned the law of cause and effect, and have just gone like, you know, crazy, you know, street dogs when they go by the scent of meat or bone, wherever they, you know, wander. So a situation like that has come. And monks have been killed. Some monks have been killed in the Serajay monastery. They've been very secretive about that. But there has been tension as a result of which there has been fighting and killing amongst the monks. So, you see, the effect is really terrible. You can't describe it.
What do you feel is the effect of this ban on the Gelugpa tradition as a tradition? What will happen to the Gelugpa tradition if this ban is not lifted? In your view, what is the future of the Gelugpa tradition if this ban is not lifted?
I think the Gelugpa tradition may have many protectors. That is for sure. The three main protectors instituted for Gelugpa tradition is Mahakala, Vaishravana and Kalarupa. Of course. But the uncommon protector for the Gelugpas is Dorje Shugden. Now if this ban on Dorje Shugden is not lifted, since Dorje Shugden is the uncommon protector for the Gelugpas, it goes to say without doubt that the future of the spread of the Gelugpa teachings, the protection of the Gelugpa teachings, which basically means the protection of our own minds and our own conditions and facilities to be able to practice that pure Ganden lineage, I think will be lost. So I think there won't be any future for the Gelugpa tradition.
What do you feel is the impact on Buddhism in the world from a global point of view right now? What will be the implications or the consequences for Buddhism in the world, both now and in the future, if this ban remains in place, if the Dalai Lama does not lift this ban?
I think the implications in the future for Buddhism in general will be very bad, especially because even if the Dalai Lama says that this Dorje Shugden issue is a very minor, small little issue being highlighted by a group of fanatical followers of Geshe Kelsang Gyatso, as he puts it, or his government puts it, you see? What they are trying to undermine the fact that there are people who are not happy. What he's trying to undermine the fact is basically bury a reality of the suffering of thousands of practitioners out in India who have no voice. And that now is being presented by the spirited students of Geshe-la and Geshe-la himself. So we feel happy about that. We feel really inspired, and people like myself feel a little courage to come out and do something. And so, you see, this is not a matter of a handful of people, a minority. Just because those thousands of monks dare not speak, dare not say anything, just because those very eminent Gelugpa Lamas dare not open their mouth to the Dalai Lama, doesn't mean he can do anything he likes, doesn't mean he can say anything he likes and cover up facts and reality. You see, the fact is that because this is not a minor issue, this is a major issue, which the Dalai Lama and his government is trying to manipulate and undermine by making it look like a minor. By doing that in itself, you see, they know for themselves what a great harm and what a big problem it is actually. And if the Dalai Lama does not himself solve this problem, this will create a very bad schism in the future. And this will create a very bad impression in the future amongst all the practitioners. In fact, he will bring a bad reputation to himself. It's not so much what we do as demonstrating and standing up in vigils and asking him for religious freedom. It is more his intolerant stand that will eventually spread everywhere. And people are intelligent. They will learn. They will know. They are not stupid. So it will create a bad reputation for him in the long run, not a good reputation. So it will be damaging to him and harmful to the teachings, to the spread of the teachings. And if he gets away with this, it means he can do similar things to the protectors of other traditions too, which then will contribute to the fragmenting of all Tibetan traditions, where you will see one day that there's nothing left. You see, that's why I think this is a very dangerous situation.
Rinpoche, in your estimate, how many practitioners of Dorje Shugden are there in the world as a whole? How many people are actually directly or indirectly affected by this ban, by being Dorje Shugden? And this is by being Dorje Shugden practitioners. This is not just those in India, in the United States, but in the world as a whole?
Well, what I can say is Within the world as a whole, there are 2 million Dorje Shugden practitioners. This comprises of Mongolia, China, Tibet, Taiwan, Singapore, Malaysia, Indonesia, India, of course, Nepal, the United Kingdoms, Netherlands, Germany, Italy, United States, Mexico, and even Brazil. Brazil. And there may be a few more places I can't remember. Anyway, all the followers in all these places, I would say safely, I would estimate them as 2 million people. And I think, without fail, without doubt, all these 2 million people have been affected. Now, the effect on those who are actively protesting, opposing the ban, people such as Geshe Kyaltsang Gyaltso, and people such as myself, we are directly threatened, and we are experiencing the backlash, and we are experiencing the consequences of threats to our life. But even those who would not be openly opposing it, but would be silently continuing their practices, it doesn't matter whether they oppose or whether they do not oppose, even they are threatened. So can you imagine the number of people who still continue practicing? They don't feel safe. When they travel out, that feeling of safety, that feeling of joy is not there anymore. Many monks have left from the settlements and have returned back to Tibet. They basically say there's no more joy, there's no more happiness. They don't feel welcome, they don't feel joy, they don't feel safe. Many monks have left. Some monks have left the monasteries and have started wandering in the northern parts of India and in Nepal. And they basically say they don't feel like returning back to the monastery because it's not like what it used to be. And so what I'm trying to say is that there's a universal effect which everybody feels, and the common feeling is that of sadness, disappointment.
Rinpoche, three last questions. They can be as brief as you wish.
Yes, okay.
The first question is, will the Dalai Lama lift the ban?
Well, this is rather a difficult question for me, right? This solely depends on him, actually. To lift or not lift the ban actually solely depends on him. But I think if you look at the Dalai Lama's changing agendas, and changing policies, it wouldn't be difficult to say in that sense that, you know, perhaps the Dalai Lama will uplift the ban. That's what I can say from one aspect, from one point of view. On the other hand, you see, it looks like he wants to really stick to this particular, you know, policy of his, this ban on Dorje Shugden. And that he's really going to play it tough. Now, if that's his idea, then I wonder how long it's going to take for him when he finally agrees to uplift the ban. That's why I'm saying it's a difficult question for me.
Yeah. Okay, the second question is, why will he lift the ban? If he does lift the ban, why will he lift the ban?
Well, I think, as I have basically said, you know, his changing policies is one reason why he would consider lifting his ban, and why he would consider saying, I've made an observation that the fact that I put this ban now does not stand valid. It was valid at that time, but now it looks, according to my observation, it's not valid, so I'm going to uplift the ban, you know. The reasons which he might give out in the future, you know, may not be what we expect, you know, may not be what we expect. It might be completely different. So that's what I'm saying. If he may lift the ban, he may have these kind of reasons. On the contrary, again, he might see the futility. He might realize the futility of his really having taken a hard line throughout this issue. And then he might soften somewhere in the long run. That's also another possibility. That also may be another reason for his changing the ban.
Can you predict when he might change, lift the ban? Will this be soon?
Predict. that's making it more impossible for me. Now, say for example, I said he will lift the ban tomorrow. What do you say? Now, this is really difficult for me to say.
Yeah, that's fine.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you very, very much for this.
Sure, you're most welcome.
That's
okay.